The scene opens in the year 1967, showing a spacecraft pilot and the Colonel Vladimir Karev, who is returning to Earth after completing his mission. As he prepares to penetrate the Earth's surface, his entire spaceship, Soyuz-1, is suddenly engulfed by an unknown bright light, seemingly resulting in his death. The scene then cuts to several years later, showcasing an expedition to Mars, which is led by Swedish billionaire William Meyer. 10 months into the journey, the crew of the Ulysses spaceship reaches Mars's orbit. Before initiating the landing procedure, Captain Martin Nock instructs the ship's AI assistant Irene to verify all system settings. During a team briefing, William reveals how he spent 4 years preparing for this journey and sacrificed almost all of his money. However, an American company called Zillion seems to have beaten them, as they've managed to land on Mars 2 weeks ago regardless. Earth has received no communication from the American crew except for a video warning not to come to Mars. This warning arises a dispute among the Ulysses crew members, but the captain declares that they will land at any cost. Later on, William has a private conversation with the mission's therapist Jean Renoir and asks her about her thoughts on landing on Mars. She expresses her opposition to the landing, as she believes that the 10-month journey has exacerbated dangerous neurosis among some of the crew members. She details their current situation. An engineer named Basil shows sociopathic symptoms while the CEO is breaking up with his wife, which can negatively affect his judgment and decision-making. Meanwhile, another crew member, Simon, is disconnected from the chain of command and doesn't talk to the captain. How did any of these guys get hired? Being an astronaut is hard. As the crew prepares to land, AI Irene verifies all the required systems and stumbles upon a problem. The ship doesn't uncouple from the carrier system. This poses a great threat to the crew, because if they don't uncouple, they'll fall into Mars like a stone and burn up. After a while of deliberating, they conclude that the only solution is to carry out the uncoupling process manually. The captain then volunteers to venture out and fix the problem. Upon making his way out of the spaceship, he proceeds to the uncoupling lever and pulls it down, but before he can return, the spaceship experiences turbulence, throwing the captain off into open space. Despite this tragedy, the team has no time to mourn, as the ship is plummeting down towards Mars' surface. Soon after, it causes a power outage that shuts down Irene, forcing the crew members to solely rely on manual landing. After a lot of trouble, they finally manage to land on the Red Planet. However, the problem is still not solved, because they're unable to restart Irene without the AI. The life support system is non-functional, leaving them with only 24 hours of oxygen. Upon inspecting the spacecraft, they figure out that excessive fuel consumption during the landing has depleted the power needed to restart the ship. Now the only option is to wait 48 hours for the solar panels to generate sufficient power for the generators. However, they don't have that much time, so the crew resorts to finding an alternative solution. Simon, who has now assumed the role of the captain, proposes locating the American ship Zillion and retrieving necessary equipment from there. Surely they'll be easy to find. This planet can't be that big. Acting on this plan, Simon, Jean, and Eva set out on a rover. While the rest of the team persists in their efforts to restart the ship, Basil recalls the AI energy saving function and immediately initiates a reboot process, but to no avail. Meanwhile, Simon's team locates the American ship that was easy, but it's crashed and completely wrecked. Finding nothing useful, they decide to head back to their ship en route. They spot an unconscious man in a spacesuit with a box beside him. As the crew approaches to check on him, they realize that he's breathing, so Jean insists that they take him along. Simon expresses his concern about their limited oxygen level, but Jean somehow manages to persuade him. Afterwards, Simon and the crew arrive back at the ship, but their fellow crew member Yen refuses to let them in, stating that 4 survivors are better than 8 corpses. The other members are against Yen's decision and get into an argument with him, but he remains resolute. Amidst this, the unconscious man wakes up, which inexplicably restores the ship's functionality, leaving everyone bewildered. Later, during interrogation, the man identifies himself as Soviet Cosmina Vladimir Kov, serving for the USSR government. When the crew asks a few more questions, Vladimir answers in a confident manner, which raises suspicion that he might be suffering from PTSD and that he's telling them what his brain has captured before the traumatic incident. They then decide to quarantine him until he recovers from the stress. For now, they send the information to Earth seeking further details. A few hours later, they get a response from Earth saying that there were no Russians in Zillion. Moreover, they are informed that Vladimir was reported dead in 1967, making him over 90 years old. Even if he was alive, this perplexes the crew as Vladimir doesn't look that old at all. Being a therapist gone is then tasked with questioning Vladimir. However, the only thing he confesses is that he's feeling hungry. Jean then goes to get some food for him while the others try to contemplate the situation. In the meantime, Basil approaches Eva and shares his unproven theory. Vladimir might have been waiting for them to land on Mars. Back at in the quarantine room, Gon offers food to Vladimir while broaching the subject of his reported disappearance in the past. She presents news of his reported death 50 years ago, and even his burial by his family. Despite the unsettling revelation, Vladimir stays calm and instead asks if she doesn't believe in her eyes. Apart from all of this, their spacecraft remains unreliable due to lack of fuel, preventing them from leaving. The next day, Vladimir mysteriously vanishes from the ship. Despite its highly secured entrance and exit doors, Simon searches the entire place, but fails to locate him. Shortly after, they discover that his spacesuit is missing, indicating that he somehow managed to get out of the ship. Taking swift action, Simon, William, Jean, and Yen board their rover and follow the heat trail tracked by Irene, while the remaining team members analyze Vladimir's DNA. After some time, the crew makes a startling discovery. Vladimir's DNA possesses a third strand, unlike that of a typical human. They prompt share this finding with the rest of the crew, and Eva asserts that no known life form exhibits such a DNA structure. Not long after, Simon and his team find Vladimir standing next to an unusual rocky structure with a small stone pyramid on its top. When questioned about it, Vladimir says it's Mars delivers, but also claiming that this planet has been awaiting their arrival for a very long time. Elsewhere, the founder of the Zillion Corporation, Ivan Goldstein, whose chef was the first to arrive on Mars, is informed about the discovery of a person on the Red Planet. Researchers claim that the man's presence there is unnatural, precisely referring to him as an alien in human form. According to them, the only extraterrestrial life form capable of surviving for such a long time is artificial intelligence. Back on Mars, Vladimir is brought back to the Ulysses and subjected to interrogation. However, he claims to have no recollection of how he opened the ship door and got out. Later on, Irene conducts a study of the strange structure and concludes that it closely resembles structures from ancient civilizations on Earth. This indicates that someone was inspired by human civilization, or humans borrowed these elements from extraterrestrial beings in the past. Amidst their discussions, the crew notices another spaceship landing on the planet and assumes it to be sent by Ivan. Filled with hope for rescue, they immediately try to establish communication via radio. And to their delight, the ship's cap, Gemma, assures them that they will help them out. Nevertheless, William doesn't trust Ivan, so he suggests that they hide Vladimir from them. As a result, Jean provides Vladimir with a uniform in order to make him blend in as one of their crew members a short while. Later, two military men, Lieutenant Colonel Edward Doino and Major Adam Wayne, arrive at their spaceship. Simon welcomes them wholeheartedly, but the two armed personnel behave in a cold manner. Edward demands that they hand over the same body, which they retrieved from the wreckage of the Zillion spacecraft. When the crew hesitates, the officers say that they'll only help if they comply with their orders. Left with limited choice, William hands over the box, after which the duo departs, claiming that they will return soon. Later, Eva and Basil study the rocky structure and find out that it is made up of an alloy that doesn't exist on Earth. However, it is known from ancient sources and was once called orichalcum, the metal of Atlantis. In addition to iron, zinc, copper, and nickel, it contains triple helix DNA similar to Vladimir's. Upon learning of this revelation, William suggests that they keep this discovery a secret, because Ivan will take Vladimir away if he becomes aware. At this point in time, a small argument ensues between the crew members, as some of them want to trade Vladimir to Ivan and return home, while some want to stay there to unveil the actual truth. In the next scene, Jean invites Vladimir to her cabin and asks for permission to use hypnosis on him. She actually wants to extract some more information from him. Vladimir unexpectedly agrees, so she hypnotizes him into revealing how he ended up there. As he begins to share his account, the other crew members watch their conversation through a monitor from outside the cabin. Vladimir discloses that he was trying to land his Soyuz-1 when he saw something unusual in space. It started to engulf his entire ship, also raising the temperature exponentially. Before he can reveal further, Vladimir starts feeling increasingly uncomfortable, making Gon unable to control him. Soon after, the connection disrupts, causing the monitor screen to go blank. Concerned for Jean's safety, the crew members hastily break into the cabin, only to find the two of them tonguing each other down. The following day, Gemma and her colleague Alan arrive in Ulysse. They apologize for sending military personnel earlier, explaining it as a precautionary measure. They then expressed their willingness to assist them in repairing the spacecraft and facilitating their departure. Following this, engineer Alan begins his work while William guides Gemma on a tour of his spaceship. Later, as Gemma converses with Simon and Dion, she unintentionally mentions one of William's secrets. The expedition wasn't solely for exploring the planet. Turns out that 4 years ago, a rover from Mars sent some photographs to Earth, revealing the discovery of a stellium information storage system that can be rewritten. This revelation infuriates Yen and Simon, who then lash out at William for hiding such a big detail from them. Yan declares that he no longer trusts him and regards him as a betrayer. Furthermore, he expresses that he is ready to switch sides and team up with Ivan rather than working with him. Subsequently, Basil approaches William with a startling revelation. Vladimir's DNA functions as a data processing entity, which makes him a living computer program. To back up his claim, he reminds how Vladimir activated the entire ship as soon as he entered it. He also asserts that Vladimir was the one responsible for cutting off the monitor footage from Jean's cabin earlier. Later that day, William goes to Jean and shows her some pictures received from Mars 4 years ago. He reveals how those pictures formed Jean's face when deciphered, the reason why he chose her for the expedition. Upon realizing how she has been used as a puppet by him, she feels disappointed and walks away. Later, as Jean is in her cabin, she suddenly experiences a vision of herself back at home. In the vision, she is approached by Vladimir, who tells her that she is the link between Earth and Mars, and that he has been waiting for her for thousands of years. He also tells her that she now has to make a difficult decision and hands her a coordinate to somewhere on Mars. Subscribe for more videos like this, turn on notifications, and leave a like to help the channel out. Thank you for watching.